Good afternoon, and thank you so much for coming. Can you hear me okay? Okay. That's much better. Good afternoon, and thank you so much for being here. It's been such such a pleasure to be here getting to know the organ at Hyde Park Community United Methodist Church, and everyone I've met has shown me such a wonderful welcome, so thank you so much for that. The piece you just heard comes to us from 17th century North Germany. Nikolaus Bruns lived and worked in the port city of Husum, and he composed in the early Baroque style, that's how we talk about it now anyway, and you'll notice that those two fugue subjects within that piece had a lot in common. They were almost the same, but one was in two and the other one was in three. And this style had a lot of influence on Bach as he wrote his early preludes and fugues. And in fact, there are some that have almost that exact same form that we just heard. Now let's go south to Dresden, where Gottfried August Homelius worked for most of his career. Homelius was actually a student of Bach, but as you will hear in the next two pieces, he very much departed from the style of the Baroque era into a style that we now call the Stilgewand, which was the kind of bridge between Baroque and classical eras. The music is a lot more dainty, maybe you would say charming. It's not as dense, it's not as intense, and the form is just straight through, just one thing. And I think it's funny that Homelius, who worked in the major churches in Dresden, wrote these chorale preludes on the text, Jesu meine Zuversicht, and that means Jesus my sure defense. And these two pieces don't really conjure up the images of battle and triumph over death that the text of the chorale states, but maybe it just didn't matter as much to Homelius to paint the text in the ways that was common with his predecessors in the Baroque era. So nevertheless, lovely music. Please enjoy these two chorale preludes on Jesu meine Zuversicht.
Thank you.
No falling mics this time. I want to tell you about the next three pieces as a set. They are all from American composers who lived in the 20th and 21st century, and I didn't really plan this, but I was thinking about the program, and they're all kind of influenced by jazz in different ways. The first piece, Fast and Sinister, is by Leo Sowerby, who lived in Chicago for much of his career and worked at the Episcopal Cathedral of St. James there, and he was also known as the Dean of American Church Music. The story behind this piece is that in 1929, the publishing company Oxford University Press approached Sowerby asking if he might write a short piece for inclusion in an anthology of American organ music, but instead he wrote a 30-minute long symphony that ended up not being included in that volume, but rather published on its own. And this is the middle movement. It is fast, as it says. Maybe it's sinister, maybe it's not. But there are two main themes. The first one appears for the first time in the pedal, so you can listen for that. And then later, it's in all of the different voices. And then the second theme is on chords on the oboe that's in the back. So just be listening for those two. There are three main sections in the piece, and the piece gradually gets louder and more insistent, and there's more and more going on, but it's a blast to play. After that, we'll hear a piece by another Chicago-based composer, Florence Price, who is noted for the accolade of being the first Black American woman to have works played by major orchestras. She was extremely prolific and wrote many different styles of music. And this movement comes from her Suite for Organ from 1942. And it's a nice foil to the other two pieces in this set. It's very calm and just lush harmonies, beautiful melodic lines, and hopefully you'll hear some sounds you haven't yet heard on the instrument. I like to say that if this piece were a work of art, it would be impressionist, just lush pastels, gorgeous scenery. And then the last piece in the set is by Ann Wilson, her Toccata. She lives actually in Cleveland and teaches at Case Western University, and the jazz influence is very clear here, but more of modern contemporary jazz, walking bass lines and really pungent harmonies. You will hear the loud trumpet in the back, so just want to warn you about that. And it's just a blast. So I hope you enjoy these next three pieces, Sowerby, Price, and Wilson.
Thank you. Thank you.
Does anybody know the musical quote that was in that piece? It spells a certain composer's name. Anybody get it? Did we hear Bach, B-A-C-H? Yeah, you can go back and listen for it after the concert. Forgot to warn you about that. Yeah, he knew. Okay. So for the rest of the concert, we're going to be in France, and I'll play for you two composers who lived in the 20th century, very different styles. And I'll go ahead and tell you about the Durufle Suite, which does not need much introduction, especially if you're an organist or an organ lover. Maurice Durufle was extremely self-critical of his works and only published 7 opus numbers for organ during his lifetime. But the suite is one of the most substantial solo organ works, consists of 3 movements, and he dedicated the work that he wrote in the early 1930s to his teacher, Paul Dukas, who wrote the well-known Sorcerer's Apprentice. So I think you can especially hear the influence from his teacher in the first movement, which is kind of like a funeral dirge, and it builds up incessantly, insistently, throughout the whole movement to full organ, and then back down again, and then out of the ashes rises a phoenix, and this beautiful, lonesome melody that you'll hear on the clarinet, which is also behind you, and then back to the opening dirge-like material. The second movement, the Sicilienne, has roots as a dance back to the Renaissance era. But of course, Durufle makes it his own. It's in a lilting 6-8, and you'll hear the melody on the oboe and in many different configurations throughout the work, and it's just sublimely beautiful. And then the toccata, which is at the end, reminds me kind of like a car chase. It really starts and it does not stop, and it's a blast. It's a whirlwind for the organist to play. I do hope you enjoy all of that. But before that, I wanted to tell you a little bit more about the work of Jean-Louis Florenz. Jean-Louis Florenz was a student of Olivier Messiaen, with whom he shared a love of birds and birdsong and being outdoors, and also lots of different scales, modes, different ways of using the notes that are both visible on the keyboard and also notes that are in between. And another thing about Florenz is that he was a great traveler, and he went all over the world. He especially loved the people and music of Africa, and he spent many hours in the library listening to field recordings that were taken in different countries of people performing music there. And so there's some influence of that love and devotion that he had in the piece that I will play for you today. He was especially touched by the Ethiopians who he met in Jerusalem during the 1980s. They were there because of the diaspora, and he was very influenced by their liturgy. So he wrote Lode, which is a 7th movement work loosely based on the Ethiopian morning prayer service. I will play for you movements 4 and 5. And movement 4 actually comes from before the rest of the work was written, when Jean-Louis Florenz in the 1970s, maybe 75, sat on a Boeing 737 for the first time. So picture yourself sitting in between where the engines are on a Boeing 737 and the sensation that that gives you, and that's what this movement is. All of the lowest pipes on the organ are sounding in the pedal at the same time, two feet at once, and there's oscillating motions that sort of imitate the upper frequencies that you might hear when you're listening to a loud plane engine. It's not just low, but it's also high sounds. And then the 5th movement, Pleurs de la Vierge, or Tears of the Virgin, is kind of a tapestry of different sounds that Jean-Louis Florenz experienced in his research. The first section is sort of his interpretation of 2 Burundian women singing a duet called the Akaheze together. The next section is sort of, it pretends to be the golden-breasted starling and its flitting movements, so you'll hear that using the tears. I won't get too into details. And then the 3rd part is a rain dance from Togo with lots of flutes just blending into one another. So do listen for those 3 things. At the end, the Burundian duet comes back. So I know that's a lot of information, but if you would like to learn more, there's more online about it. It's just fabulous music. So Florenz and then Durufle, thank you so much for being such a great audience. Thank you so much to Brenda Portman for the invitation to be here today, and to everyone who's been so wonderful during my time here. And I look forward to greeting all of you after the concert. Thank you.
Thank you.